This is ADTV. And you're watching ADTV 24/7.
To our special call-in show on coronavirus. All your queries, all your doubts, anything you want to know answered right here, not by me of course, but by doctors who are joining us. We have Dr. Arun Papa Rao, consultant physician, KIMS Hospital, joining us from Hyderabad. We also have Dr. Karandeep Singh Sehal, a consultant interventional cardiologist, Mayo Healthcare Super Speciality Hospital from Mohali. Thank you so much, doctors, for sparing your time and joining us this morning. Dr. Papa Rao, actually I want to start with you by asking you about all the trials that are taking place across the world, and you know, all these medicines being talked about. There's a remdesivir that is, you know, showing promise, but none of them are a short cure. Isn't that the issue? A lot of them are helping in containing the disease, or you know, reducing the impact of the disease somewhat, but nothing so far is you know, something that is eradicating the disease.
Good morning, Gargi. Good morning to yourself, NDTV. You're right. Actually, there is a recent trial, Gilead trial, which has given its phase 3 data. And this data shows that there is some benefit. It's not a sure shot or a silver bullet. If it takes normally 15 days for the patient to improve, in this trial, it has shown the remdesivir, it's a novel drug, it has taken just 11 days to improve. And the real death rate also found to be beneficial from 11.8 to 8. That means there is some benefit, but it is not a sure shot. As of now, there is no clear sure shot of any medication. But remdesivir found to be beneficial in the initial trials.
Now, we do know that the production of it, and you know, there have been tie-ups with Indian companies as well to produce it, but it's not been allowed anywhere so far. So how long does that take?
It depends upon the regulators and the approvals. I read that Cipla company and Hatino company got that it could take at least 2 to 3 months if they start right away.
All right, and Dr. Karandeep, when you know, testing these drugs, of course, with patients who have heart issues, any underlying issues, this obviously remains one big concern. Even at the time when Trump was talking about hydroxychloroquine as this possible drug for treatment, this was a concern about, you know, we don't want people rampantly using it who have other underlying problems.
Definitely, ma'am, definitely. Hydroxychloroquine has its own issues. Actually, in the patients of long QT syndrome, it is a particular type of syndrome. Patients were found to have arrhythmias, a different type of arrhythmias. One of them is ventricular tachycardia, and ultimately, this can lead to cardiac arrest also. So, definitely.
All right, we'll just get Dr. Karandeep back, but we have some viewers calling in. We have Babita calling from Delhi. Go ahead with your question, Babita.
Good morning. I am Babita Jagri calling from Delhi. My question is, can coronavirus be killed by ozonization of vegetables?
All right, Dr. Papara.
Yeah, the vegetables, you need not be, either ultraviolet or ozone. Does it have any definitive role? Is not yet proven. As of now, the recommendation is you have to clearly wash it under running water and leave it for half an hour, and you can start using them. And you can be sure that you have thoroughly cleaned that, and there is no problem from the virus.
All right, we're always getting questions regarding, you know, because everybody's shopping and they're very concerned about what they're getting in vegetables and when to start cooking. We have a caller from Srinagar. Javed, go ahead with your question.
Morning, Gargi. Morning, doctors. My question to the doctors is that, as you know, that the Ramzan is going on, and most of the people in Ramzan, almost 99% of people in Ramzan consume non-veg in Sahri, in Iftari. So is it advisable to take non-veg in these two times? Because there's a little gap between Sahri and Iftari. It's hardly about 6 hours of gap between Sahri and Iftari. So just wanted to know whether non-veg is advisable or no, and what kind of vegetables should we take wherein we can fight this COVID corona virus pandemic, because we don't have vaccines available, we don't have any kind of medicines available at this point of time. So just wanted to know what kind of vegetables are advisable so that we can consume those vegetables and we can fight within our body, so that our body can fight this kind of.
I'll go across to Dr. Karandeep for that. I think everybody wants to boost their immunity, but yes, doctor, what would you advise?
As it was found that in Wuhan, the origination of this coronavirus was from bats, but it is not clear that it is from the chicken or mutton. If you are consuming that, the data are not very, very sure that you can have corona from the animal products also. And if you are diabetic or you have any issues, you are taking any medicines like that, you continue with those medicines, with your medicines. And if you don't have any problem right now, you continue with your medicines. Take proper high protein diet. Take more of vegetable, more of fruits in your diet. Take plenty of water throughout the day, and take vitamin C rich products
as far as non-veg goes, isn't it that if it's well cooked then it's all right, it doesn't matter?
It is all right, the efficacy has not been that it has not been proven that patient can have corona with the non-veg food. Take food with the less fat in it, and you can cook it properly, then it is fine.
All right, we have another caller, Jyotika from Nainital. Go ahead with your question.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
Good morning, doctor. This is in reference to food intake again, sir. So how do we secure ourselves if we are consuming packed food, bottled food? Bread is a big question these days. Can you guide me on this? And this is a very popular question among all housewives here.
And on this show as well, Dr. Papara?
There is no established definitive link from any specific foods, but just to boost up the immunity, better avoid canned foods, take fresh vegetables, fresh food, fresh meat as well, and eggs, and particularly fresh fruits with broccoli and green vegetables. They are the natural immune boosters. Possibly this will improve the innate immunity. And in particular, when it comes to vitamins, vitamin D has some effect on the overall immunity of a person. So it is better to take a small doses of vitamin D, 1,000 or 2,000 units, either daily or on alternate days. And otherwise, no definite food has any specific protection or specific problem with COVID. And just make sure that the food you take is clean, hygienic, and it doesn't cause any problem in this situation.
All right, and just eat healthy overall, basically. I think both doctors are advising that. We'll take two callers now. Jahangir calling from Srinagar. Jahangir, go ahead with your question.
Good morning to everybody, and thanks. I have a question. It's regarding, like, you know, the Prime Minister and other chief ministers of the other and of the other UT, they're saying that, you know, we have to be ready to live with the corona, and we have to carry on the course of life now. But I need to get a medical opinion about it. We have the two medical experts in the panel at the moment, and I suppose the medical fraternity has got the biggest stake to decide. Do we have to really live with the corona and carry on the momentum in the life? One. Second, we need to understand the fact that all around the world, the medical experts, they've been saying it categorically, if there is going to be an extra ease in the lockdown, then there are the consequences are going to be very bad. So, I personally think we need to write about the politics, and the medical fraternity has to decide, do we really need to go with the East Town, and can we carry on with the corona in the normal course of life? Thank you.
All right, I wish we didn't have to live with it, but yes, I think with no cure, we'll get another question in. Srinivas calling from Bengaluru, go ahead with your question.
Good morning, Gagi. Good morning, doctor. See, few years ago, around 2078, this H1N1 scare was there, and I heard there is a vaccine for that also. However, we have not taken that vaccine. But that H1N1 kind of tapered off, I don't remember, but it did not spread so much. But this one, it is spreading so fast, so wide. How is it likely to end? Can you compare it with H1N1 and help me understand here?
All right, yes, even I remember H1N1, it was a huge scare, and you know, there was it was quite frightening at the start of it, but then yes, it seemed to have tapered out, though we still live with H1N1. Dr. Papara, first to you.
I tell you now, a few seconds about short story of COVID. It started with one patient, possibly from the animals to the human being. Then it has spread over rapidly like wildfire to about 200 countries. Means that the specificity of this particular virus is its contagiousness. It is highly contagious than any other viruses known in the past. We were worried about influenza or H1N1 influenza virus, and there is a vaccine which was end to the major problems of the H1N1. So as it started with one and multiplied, and it is shows that it is highly contagious, the most important thing one has to remember is your hands. Purify your hands, clean your hands. Make sure that your hands are clean, number one. Number two, when you touch your eyes, nose, mouth, don't touch them. This will reduce your risk by 99%. The mask and other things have not that big effect. However, if you contain, what is the end of this? One is antiviral drugs. As of now, there is no specific proof of any sure shot of antiviral drug.
Right.
Number two is herd immunity, with when everybody gets, and the mortality is 4 to 5%. When everybody gets, it will be a big toll. We have to curtail it before everybody gets infected. Number three is the vaccine. Vaccine is possibly the definitive treatment. There are many ongoing trials on vaccine, and there are some frontliners like Oxford vaccines, and which has a tie-up with the Serum Institute of India as well. And possibly the vaccine is now in human trials, phase one.
Right.
And phase two and three human trials will start by the end of June. And by the time Serum Institute starts with its production, and possibly if everything goes well, by the end of this year or even before that, we should be able to get a vaccine, which is the final war against the virus.
All right, we all need to keep our fingers crossed for that. But Dr. Karandeep, as Mr. Jahangir, who called from Srinagar, was asking about how politicians, we've had Arvind Kejriwal in Delhi talking about the Prime Minister too, has said we have to live with this, because as Dr. Paparao said, we're only going to get a vaccine or cure in by the end of the year, and maybe even later than that. So we obviously, our lives can't be on hold. But even as we now, restrictions lift and we go back to work, it's the people who are most vulnerable, the ones with heart disease, the elderly, the very young, they're the ones we have to be most careful about as well.
Yeah, definitely. The drugs which are active against coronavirus, the falfenavir or remdesivir, they are under phase 3 trials. And as Dr. Paparao said, that vaccine will take around 3 to 6 months to come into the market. So I think presently it seems like that we'll have to live with the virus, and we'll have to protect ourselves. We have to cover our face, our mouth, and we'll have to clean our hands, sanitize our hands with the alcohol-based sanitizers, and we'll have to wash our hands with the soap, and these are the measures we'll have to take, and especially the elderly population and those who are having the heart disease, diabetes, those who are diabetics, those who are having hypertension, they are at more risk. So we'll have to, presently it seems like that we'll have to live with it, but definitely we are going to get the medicines which are under phase 3 trials and vaccines.
Right, which is, then we'll all have to take those steps that we've been talking about: masks, gloves, constantly washing our hands, and stop touching our faces when we're out, and avoid crowded areas, of course. We have a COVID warrior, in fact, on the line with us now, Dr. Srikanth, calling in. Good morning, Doctor. What is your question?
Good morning, Good morning, madam. I'm calling from Bangalore. My name is Dr. Srikant. My question is, from the past 2 months, I have been working in the casualty department in the front lines for a public sector hospital. I have been taking all the precautions, PPE kits, and other things. Daily, I've been working in casualty, and I have been keeping my family away for more than 2 months. So I want to know the doctors if there is any epidemiological study going on, means from when we can go back to the normal, that is means without any this fear of contracting COVID.
All right, Dr. Paparavan, thank you so much for your service, Dr. Yeah. Srikant. I can just imagine, you know, this is the sacrifice doctors across the country are making, nurses as well, staying away from their families, constantly living with this fear of firstly contracting the disease and then spreading it to their family members.
I applaud the efforts of Dr. Srikant. Coming back to the epidemiology, here is we don't have a definitive data for anything about the nature of the virus. And so we are building an aeroplane and you are flying at the same time. So we have to learn. Every day is a learning experience and every day is adding to the human knowledge on the virus. And how long this will go, when we can be free from the PPEs and when human life goes like before, we never know. Possibly it changes post-COVID. There are certain changes that it brings to the human society. Certainly hand wash is going to be forever, and the hygiene, improve the hygiene, hygienic circumstances, and how long this takes to live like normal.
Right.
Earlier, we never
made
an open question.
All right, yeah. Dr. Karandeep, you can just imagine, you know, the sacrifice doctors and nurses are making across the country and this stress that they live with.
Yeah, definitely, ma'am, definitely. They are the most vulnerable people who can have COVID. They are living with the people who are having COVID, and they are the most vulnerable population. I applaud the effort of Dr. Srikant.
All right, but we'll slip into a short break now. Do keep the questions coming in, the calls coming in. We'll be back after this short break.
Knowledge Partner, USP, your reliable healthcare partner.
Welcome back. Well, we're taking all your questions on coronavirus. We have time for two quick questions. We have Abdul Ghaffar calling from Hassan. Go ahead with your question.
Good morning, madam. I want to know, I'm running a grocery shop in Hassan city. So I will get products from different cities where there is a coronavirus which is rampant. So I want to know how to maintain this hygiene when I open the products and all. Whether it will be infected by Hamalis and somebody else. Even if I exchange the notes or currency notes also, how to maintain the hygiene, please? I want to know. This
is all right, so lots of concerns with restrictions lifting. We have Ravi Shankar calling from Mumbai.
Yeah. Good morning, madam. My question is that with regard to this government servants, we have the practice of having file movement from one desk to other. So how to maintain the hygiene with respect to this file movement? Because electronically we will be doing most of the work, but
right.
In government particularly there is a system of file movement.
All right, Dr. Paparao, so clearly very similar sort of questions, even though one is concerning vegetables, the other concerning files.
It's all about sterilization. You have to suspect any surface unless you clean that, including your hand. So any products that comes from outside, but many people will be handling, who has the products, who has the virus in their hand, we never know. So it is ideal to sterilize that with a sanitizer and take a wipe of sanitizer with an alcohol swab. It's always better.
All right.
And when it comes to the ultimate consumer, they again has, they will change the hands, and when they go home, they have to clean it with alcohol sanitizers, or there are some new hydrochloro peroxide and sprays and all that, you can clean with them and leave it aside for about at least 5 to 10 minutes. It takes 1 minute for the alcohol to sterilize the virus. Depends on the surfaces, on the cardboard, the virus leaves about 24 hours.
That's something you have to watch out for. Dr. Karandeep, quick answer from you on this. And clearly, this is, you know, these habits that we keep drilling in, washing hands, sanitizing, that has to be the way forward.
Coronavirus can remain on the surface for around 2 to 5 days. For example, it remains on the metals for at least 2 days. It remains on the wooden surface for at least 5 days. So range is from 2 to 5 days. It remains on the surface for 2 to 5 days. So better to avoid touching the grocery or whatever the things you are taking from outside.
Wear gloves at work if you're dealing with files and cash.
You can use glove, but it is better to sanitize the things if you really want to touch that thing, you better to sanitize that and take full protection for that. And it is better if you can keep that thing for at least 2 to 5 away from you for 2 to 5 days and avoid touching that thing or avoid touching that grocery for at least 5 days.
Or I don't know how easy that would be for someone who's, you know, running a shop, and of course for somebody who's dealing with files constantly.
Then all your option is to sanitize that thing.
Okay, well, that's all the time we have. Thank you so much, doctors, for taking our time and answering all those questions. Thank you all for watching at home and calling in. Time for a break. We'll return with more.